you ever been badly defeated? Crushed and left for dead? Abused and so mistreated? Something you won't forget. You can't give up. You don't give up.
Er vi i Esbjerg? En skør nordmand og en halvskør dansker. Eller. Hvad så, Mike? Hvad sker der med dig?
Rock and roll. 40 års jubilæum her til sommer. Vi fortsætter.
Og så er der lige nyt album lige om hjørnet.
Nyt album på vej. Det er jo ligesom, kornet skal plantes, så det kan høstes senere henne. Nej, jeg har... det har været, ja, det er jo næsten 2 år siden, jeg indspillede det andet, så kommer det selvfølgelig ud. Så har jeg været rundt i verden og spillet 3 måneder i USA og godt rundt i Europa. Og inderst inde var det ikke, fordi jeg havde forberedt og planlagt et nyt album, men så pludselig sætter du dig ned med en guitar, og så vælter det ud, og så er det ligesom nogen, der banker på dørene. Der skal noget nyt, ikke? Og så laver du albumet, og så går du i studiet, og så ligesom alt passer ind igen, ikke? Og så forbereder du starten på et nyt år, ikke? Og et nyt album, og elektrisk og det hele.
Maybe tomorrow.
Yes.
Jamen, hvad
et, et album om sådan set, som sidder spørgsmål om håb på mange forskellige ting.
Er det pure rock and roll, eller noget tungt i?
Der er ikke noget tungt, fordi jeg synes ikke, at de citerede Mike Tramp gennem hans første karriere. repræsentere den tunge del. Det ved, jeg ved godt, der har været mere power på Freak of Nature, end der var i White Lion. Men for 20 år siden, da jeg startede mit første soloalbum, det er 20 år siden, nu har jeg 10 soloalbums, der besluttede jeg, at nu havde jeg været i nok bands. Og når du siger Mike Cram, så skal det have en lyd. Og det er den måde, jeg lyder, når jeg er for mig selv. Jeg snakker ikke det specielt, hvis det kun er mig. Men lyden, når det er mig og mine sange skrevet på den måde, skrevet til en enkelt guitar. Så det er det, at hvis du har lyst til noget, og du siger Mike Cram, så skal det have en lyd. Og den lyd skal ikke være White Lion, og den lyd skal ikke være Freak of Nature. At jeg spiller nogle af de gamle sange i mit publikum, af en respekt til både fansene og den historie, jeg har. Men de bliver arrangeret og har lyden af, hvordan jeg er i dag. Et af de vigtigste ting for mig, det er, at jeg lyder, som jeg er i dag. Og jeg ikke prøver på at leve i 1987. Fordi jeg er 65 i dag, og i 1987, der var jeg 26. Og det kan jeg bare ikke.
Ja, nemlig. Men du skal også have respekt for det, for de nye fans, ikke? Der er heller ikke for mange, når den kom ved din baggrund.
Ja, men samtidig er der mange, der glemmer, at fansene er næsten lige så gamle. Mange af dem har også, og de har fået børn, og de er lidt mere aftalt, men er deres rejse. Og så synes jeg, det er fedt, at man ligesom udvikler sig eller vokser lidt med tiden. Det er den der rødvin, at hvis du venter et år til, så smager den bedre. Og jeg er meget stolt af min historie. Jeg er meget stolt af White Lion-årene. Jeg er meget stolt af Freak of Nature-årene. Men hvis du spørger ærligt, så føler jeg, at jeg er det stærkeste, jeg nogensinde har været i dag.
Hvad kan vi forvente os af det nye album så?
Du kan forvente en selvsikkerhed, at der er ikke noget en mand, som søger eller eksperimenterer, men en mand, som er kommet hjem, som er både trofast, men også føler sig virkelig komfortabel i sin liv. Og jeg siger til mange, like it or not, det her er Mike Cram.
Der har du mulighed til at se nogle ting til Heavy Rock Show.
Jamen, jeg er jo bare dødtaknemmelig for supporten for alle fansene, og ved, at jeg er bare en side i den store tykke bog af hard rock, og det er jeg tilfreds med.
Jeg hedder Søren Andersen, og lige nu der kigger du på Heavy Rock Show. Jesper, og så kom til at spille i aften med Mike Trump.
Åh oh, ja.
Fortæl, hvad sker der med dig for tiden?
Hvad sker der ikke med mig?
Glenn Houston den anden dag, Mike ja. Trump den anden dag.
Jeg har fandme, jeg har et ret hæftigt år, og jeg får det også næste år. Altså, jeg har været med Glenn i, siden 2009 har jeg været med Glenn on and off, og nu er jeg tilbage sådan rimelig fast. Vi har lavet en ny plade sammen, og vi starter en kæmpe tur til januar. Så ringede Mike og sagde, hvad fanden, Søren, jeg har lige den her tur i marts, og jeg har nogle jobs i december, og så kigger jeg på min kalender, og så tænker jeg, ja, det kan jeg jo godt nå. Så det, eller så har jeg jo ligesom med Mike kun været studie musiker og producer i på de sidste 3-4 plader, kan man sige. Men altså, vi er jo gamle venner efterhånden, ikke? Jeg kender med 10 år, og det er bare fedt at være med ham igen på den måde her, fordi det er så velkendt, og så jeg elsker jo. Jeg synes jo, genre er røvkedeligt. Det er meget sjovere bare at sige, hey, er det good music, eller er det ikke good music? Jeg elsker Trains sådan lidt Tom Petty-agtig vibe. Det kan jeg pisse godt lide. Og imellem alt det, så når jeg sgu også lige at lave en plade med Electric Guitar, så den kommer ud i februar, hvor vi så spiller tur i Danmark med det. Og så kommer Mike lige med en stak shows i april nu. Fuck altså, det er bare fedt. Så måtte jeg sige nej til en Jolin Turner-tur desværre. Det vil jeg rigtig gerne, men den måtte jeg sige nej tak til, så jeg har bare...
Han har en græker til hjælp til.
Jeg har rigtig fedt, jeg synes, fra Grækenland, der hjælper ham. Jeg siger, you know, jeg er da bare vildt stolt af, at det pludselig er begyndt at være sådan rimelig fast, at jeg bare er ude at turnere hele tiden. det er fedt.
Normalt så ses vi til langt de fleste festivaler i Danmark.
Ja.
Og nu ved jeg jo, du har jo spillet en hel del med elektriske guitars.
Ja.
Og du siger et nyt album nu her i februar.
Ja.
Er det den samme liste, eller hvad hedder det? Så skal der noget mere powerful i den, eller?
Med elektriske guitars?
Ja.
Altså, vi har helt klart fået det slippet til. Og fået det ligesom... hvad fanden skal jeg sige? Jeg var jo vikar med D&D sidste år, ikke? Hvor jeg spillede bas for Stil, som knækkede armen, ikke? Og det gav mig nogle værktøjer, jeg ved ikke, du kan forestille dig, når man pludselig står med de der D&D-hits foran 5.000 mennesker aften efter aften, så kan man pludselig mærke det der, hold da kæft, det der er sådan lidt, hvad fanden skal jeg kalde det, knallert rock, som D&D spiller, det var bare pisse inspirerende. Så Mika og mig, vi holdt et langt møde om sådan noget med, hvad skal den næste plade være, og hvordan...
Ja.
Og så kom jeg bare med det her, hey, skulle man gå lidt mere CC Top vejen, og lidt mere Thin Lizzy riffy. Og så begyndte vi at skrive sådan nogle sange, og det var bare virkelig, virkelig fedt at lægge den syrede del lidt på hylden, og så lave noget lidt mere potent classic rock. Og så kom vi til at snakke om, fuck man, hvordan ville det virke, hvis vi teamede op med en producer? For ellers så plejer vi jo bare at gøre det selv. Jeg har et studie, så jeg kan jo selv tracke. Så vi har kopper fra D&D til at producere pladen, og det har gjort en kæmpe forskel. Altså, det har været en helt fantastisk ting for os at have en advokat til ligesom at styre
det hele.
Til at styre det hele, ja. Og så efter noget tid, der var ligesom et af numrene, der hedder Headless Chicken, som var næsten stjålet af den måde, D&D gør det på. Den der måde med, at man synger noget, og så kommer der omkvædet, der hedder Sleeping My Day! Den havde jeg planket så meget, at det var ligesom, okay, det kan vi kraften ikke, det kan vi sgu ikke indspille. Med mindre at vi får Jesper Binser til at synge den.
Jeg skulle lige til at se.
Så jeg ringede til Jesper og sagde, hey, nu jeg ved, kunne man forestille sig? Så sendte jeg ham det, så sagde han, det er pisse sjovt, hvis jeg må skrive min egen tekst. Så skrev han sin egen tekst, der kom ned, og så sang han det ind på en formiddag. Og det lyder kraftigt med sjovt, fordi det er jo bare Binser. Han har bare den der stemme, han har, ikke?
Kunne vi få os Binser som en gæstvokalist på et eller andet tidspunkt på en eller anden festival?
Jeg vil elske det. Altså, jeg vil elske det. Og han godt lide os, vi godt lide ham, og you know, det er i hvert fald, det er ikke uladet sig gørligt, men det er jo for fanden altså, han skal også hvile der, han skal hjemmefra, men det var sjovt.
Chasing her number one dream, that you remember her name. This is our day job.
This is what we do for a living.
So we need to work. We need to work. So it's all about working.
If we're about vacationing with with a bit of playing.
If we could come to Scandinavia five times a year, we would.
Normally, we would like to see Anvil heading some of these big festivals down in Germany.
So would we, but it doesn't look like the promoters want us to. So
how come? I mean, playing
how come?
Hell of a good music.
Oh, if we could answer those questions, then we'd be able to be there, wouldn't we? There's a lot of unanswered questions throughout our entire career. Mm-hmm. You know, it's just the way. It's just what is. It's not like you have a choice or you can make it different. It's what it is, you know.
It's not normal to see huge stars like yourself playing small clubs, small venues.
Right, because the audience has changed and there's nothing older established artists can do about that. That's the reality. You know, young kids today have no fucking clue who Julian Antoni is. And furthermore, they don't give a fuck about him.
Okay.
How's he gonna fill the place with young people?
You show me a 20-year-old kid today who knows exactly who he is. He hasn't even got a fucking clue.
It's an example.
It could be Anvil, it could be fucking... even Bon Jovi doesn't have somebody not what it once was, you know what I mean? Times have changed, you know? And the artists from the 80s, they have their audience that they had, they've all grown up. A lot of them don't follow the bands no more, and so on and so forth, right? So it's all about picking up a new audience, which is not easy to do.
We went through a portion of our career that we became so inaccessibly heavy that people that knew who we were thought we got way too heavy and didn't like it. And actually what we did is we just went back to what we were originally.
Back to the roots.
Yes. Back to the roots, exactly. Yeah.
What we do now is what we always
have done and what we're best known for. So
and we're having the best success with it also. That's how people want to hear our band. Like what we really are, not letting
influences of the younger bands into our sound. They want the original thing much more so.
You know, people don't want to hear Anvil like Pantera or like Slayer. You mean that's not who we are?
The Canadian Motorhead version.
That's right. Yeah. That's who we are. And we found our way back, and we're very happy with the direction we're at.
It's actually very, very comfortable.
Yeah.
You don't have to worry about anything. You just start writing, and it's who you are. Mm-hmm. You don't have to try to intertween and inject stuff that seems weird out of, you know, like new influence that doesn't really add anything to what we're doing. It just kind of it's detrimental. You know, you like bringing in blast beats. You don't do that to Anvil material. It just didn't work.
It doesn't fit in.
No, we're based out of a rock and roll based style.
Yeah,
truly.
Because we started out in the 70s, and really, there was no heavy metal. It wasn't really called heavy metal. It was heavy hard rock, and that's what really our roots are. We're, you know, like Rob and I have been playing together since 73, so it pretty much says it all. And in the age group that we belong to. And when we try to incorporate what people twisted out of our music to be what it became and try to add that back into our sound, it's like, no, man, that's not what you guys are. You guys are the other stuff. So, yeah.
What's been happening is the world has actually been catching up to us, if you really want to know the truth. Been catching up to us, mm-hmm. discovering us, finding out what we're all about. We're still the same.
The movie, Anvil.
Yeah. Well, that brought us full-time job with the band. And it's also brought us a young audience. and we've been blessed with that. We have young people now interested in our music.
And it's like, that's very, very, that's a big, 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 big win for us. You know, to be relevant to the young kids today.
They really can relate.
It's a new audience. You're not depending on the old geezers to buy your records or listen to your music. You're young kids that are tuning in. And
yeah, it's great to see in our shows. You know, you see young people, older people, big people, little people, women, girls. It's a big change.
How many of the heavy metal or rock artists are 25 at the moment? Have you seen one?
Well, that's something that we talk about. Tell us name one band of today that can fill an arena. 25-year-old guys.
Nobody.
There isn't.
Doesn't exist. Name us a guitar hero of 25.
Of today.
Who's the new generation kids? Who's your guitar hero? Who's your drum hero?
I would like to say, who's the guitar hero? Maybe on PlayStation.
Four or five. Right. But, so times just changed. Mm-hmm. You know, and the new generation kids didn't deliver. And they all want
to
be
there's no way to deliver. You see, the thing is, initially what drove heavy metal was guitar playing. Guitar playing went through a whole evolution till it reached the top. You can't play any more notes per second. You can't add any more scales because they play every scale a million miles an hour. It's got to the top. There is no further that it goes, and the bar is set. So every guitar player at a minimum plays a million miles an hour and it all sounds the same. So now there's no guitar heroes, no breakthroughs anymore. It's all gone. Everything that could be invented has been invented. So there's only the thing that is left is redo it, or do it in a new way, do it the same thing in a new way.
Try to reinvent it.
But, and that's the best it can hope for.
If they are doing it, nobody's rising.
No one's rising because you've already got the guys who actually broke through and there's been no one after. So where is it? There is no real propellant. So it's not about initially about the ability of each musician like it once was. Now it's all about the songs. It's really, there's nothing left. What is your song? That's what separates you.
What is heavy metal in 20 years?
It's probably going to still exist.
Yeah, there's no end to how many riffs you can play, and it's completely endless in that level, and you can use them, all different kinds of influences of the whole spectrum of what it is to make a new thing, but generally it's all redundant. It's all being rehashed.
Like the band that's playing with us, one of the bands here tonight, they're younger guys, very young generation band. And they talk to us all the time, and to them, they look up to everything that was from our time. That's what is cool to them. And they said to me that no band from their generation will be ever the same as the great bands in the 80s. That's how these
Because the 80s were the breakthrough years. Once it's done, it's done. Like, you can only invent the light bulb once. And come up with different permeations of it, but basically it's just a bulb that sends out light, and that's where we are now. The electric guitar is in almost every type of music that you can listen to, everything from polka to country and western. So
I was thinking more like the new bands coming up, Volbeat.
Well, they're mixing styles.
Yeah, but Volbeat,
that's the best that you can do at this point.
Yeah,
is
a band
mixed
like
styles.
A band like that is basically sounds like Metallica.
Yeah,
nothing new there.
You know, they might mix in some classical music, they might mix in even country and western, and it's all of a sudden...
Even classical music that they've been doing.
Or classical music, yeah. Which is generally what the European bands do. Yeah. They draw from the culture of classical music, because generally speaking, that's where they come from, and that's where the roots really all came from, you know. The rock and roll stuff and the blues... It's all really from America, and the interpretation of it in the early years in Britain and Germany, it's mixed with classical influences, and that's what made the metal thing, what it was, sort of somewhat of a melting pot. But now everything and virtually everything has been done. So what do? You got to start mixing, you know, whatever you can. If it's,
that's it.
I mean, when I listen to some of the speed metal, they're actually playing polka music. It's 1-2, button, 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 button. What's the difference? Instead of going, but really the beat is still button, 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 button. It's a polka beat.
that came to me was, okay, I got a new producer, new sound in it. It was for me a completely different anvil compared to 6 years before that. Yeah.
Yeah, of course, because we didn't have a producer.
Those Dark Year records were not exactly...
They're self-productions. Yeah. You did whatever you thought was right. You didn't have expertise there. You just... guys in the studio going, well, that sounds good.
Engineers, not real producers. Yeah. And ourselves, you know, we were not the producers, but we need that extra outside...
Yeah, you need
extra,
somebody
else.
Yeah, you need a...
And Hope and Hell was made with Bob Marlett, who was a top-notch producer. And he was able to take the songs. We wrote the songs without nobody involved. The producer had nothing to do with the songwriting. He did all that. But he was able to give us the mix that made it attractive.
It is, yeah, very
like, good. Like, you go, wow, Abel sounds kind of cool.
You sound a bit surprised when you say it sounds kind of cool. Were you surprised when you first heard the new sound?
No, it was really pleasing.
We've been waiting for that for many years.
Oh, that's how you get that sound. Yeah, oh, like, oh, that's how you do that.
Yeah, for us it was like, wow, it's about time that was that sounds good. Let me feel
warm. I've heard some
a producer's job. He works in a studio 24/7. Musicians work on stage. It's two different worlds. You can't know how to record yourself and also be a live band. It just, unless you've been in the studio for years and years, you're not gonna really know how to translate your live thing into a really proper
production
where it gives you the energy that you actually express live. That's a whole
That's very hard to translate, you know, the live thing to a studio recording.
Two different booths.
Yeah,
they're two different approaches, exactly.
Very hard to do. A lot of bands strive for it, I mean, we all do, to bring that live energy in a studio recording. But it's very difficult because it's a sterile environment. Everything's under the microscope, right? Mm-hmm. Everything's detailed, you can have it perfectly. Live, it's a little more loose, you know?
And actually, what gives it the energy is the imperfection.
And the fact that
what you need to do is
you need to have audience energy too.
Yeah, you know? You need a producer who becomes the audience.
He becomes the audience.
And he goes, he listens to what you're doing and he goes, no, we need this, or you need that, or you should elongate that, or you should hold the note on that, or we need to bolster that. We need more tracks on that section to bring the energy up because there's just not enough there. You know, it's having that that ear that can hear into the future. You think that you're, oh, that's great. And the producer goes, no, but if you did this, you're going to grow tired of that. You're going to say, that should have been taken to the next level. And when he does it, he goes, try this. Because he hears you doing one thing and then it inspires him from an objective perspective to bring you, and then you do it. And then you go, fuck, I would have never thought of that. I would have thought of it in 5 years from now when I went back and listened to it, when I've got an objective view on it. But right now, I didn't hear it go to there. And that's what you need a producer for. Crucial.
Our last four records that we've made have all been made with incredible producers. And they're perhaps our
they best. They are the best recordings.
There are,
no question.
They're our best recordings that we've done since the first early days. You know,
there are a lot of musicians that have a lot of, so much ego. What do you need a producer for? My ears are good enough. I know what's happening. No musician can hear themselves objectively. You think you can, and but it takes time to hear yourself objectively, because when you write a song, you hear it from that one perspective as the writer. You're not listening to it as the listener. The only person that can listen to it as the listener is the producer. Before it goes to the people.
Yeah.
And then he can go, no, you know what? That could be better.
Or
and that's what you need.
Or, you know, I got a better idea or whatever. Yeah.
Because you won't hear that unless ultimately you go record your record. If you want objectivity, what you have to do is you go record your whole record the best you can as yourself as musicians and produce it yourself, and then put the thing away for about 2 years. Don't listen to it, don't practice it, don't do nothing. Now turn it on and you'll hear all the flaws, and you'll be able to hear what you've done objectively, because you'll have forgotten what you've recorded, and now you're hearing it for what it really is. The only way that you're going to get that is hiring that guy whose job it is to hear it at the moment and change it to what you would change it to in 2 years from now. And that's what the difference is. You need objectivity. There's no way you can do it without it.
The Bob Rand experience for us was very, very productive, and we learned a lot from it. Especially with Zelle, like, he took a lot away from his influence on producing our music.
Instead of worrying about what the whole song structure is, now I just have to worry about the best performance on the piece of music.
This is one of your favorite tracks from the album.
Yeah, one of the favorites.
Yes.
Yeah,
well, tell me about it.
We enjoy it. It's a good track.
Yeah. Well, I'm a huge Black Sabbath fan, and I believe that the fundamentals and the basics of everything that all metal bands have been doing is all rooted in Black Sabbath music. So the closer I get to those influences, the more satisfied I feel. So that's what it is. In a very Sabbath-y overtone. Even the song, the meaning of the song and the lyrics, you could say doom, which is what that dealt with. And I guess that's part of what makes it very Sabbath-y. Mm-hmm. You know, so it's because it's very close to the root.
Yeah.
That album was produced by a different producer, though. But he also brought real magic to that production.
Destruction may one day be employed. The human race.
serious about it. And Lips suggested to me, initially, it was a real discussion with somebody. He goes, you know what? Maybe you should make the cover for the song. And I said, really? You know, like I was in. He said, yeah.
So, and when we came up with the idea of, or the title Anvil is Anvil, Robbo got this idea. Let's do a mirror.
With a mirror.
Yeah. I said, yeah. And I made some drawings, and we showed them, and we looked over.
Yeah, it's the same thing as he's making drawings. Like I come up with a riff. It's very, very pure in all levels. When I write, let's say the musical part, Robbo helped me arrange and fix and adjust and get it to where we shape it together.
You know, we shape it.
And the same thing happened with the art. Although I'm not painting, I'm look at his artwork and I go, you know what, that shadow.
You know,
maybe
discuss things, right?
Yeah.
When I make the sketches, and you know, when you said, yeah, man, beautiful concept, go with it. So that was it. You know, I went home and I started painting it. Took me 6 months.
What do you think we want as a background? Yeah. How about bricks? Yeah. Let's make it look like that.
just something simple, though. You know, brick wall. It could have been anything, but you know, we decided that. The simple was the best, you know? Because the whole point was just anvil is anvil.
Anvil in a mirror.
Anvil in a mirror. How much more, in our opinion, that's pretty genius. You know,
it is.
But it's simple, right? So that's why I painted the cover. I could have painted other covers too.
Yeah,
but
the thing is,
the
thing is, Robbo's style is really about still life. And this was a still life concept. Couldn't be more perfect.
For
his style of art, you apply it to that, perfect.
So that's the reason why.
Robbo, do the next cover.
Well, it will depend on what that is. What we call it,
and what
the artwork would be called for.
Yeah.
Some things it's just not.
It's not the style.
It's not within the style.
You know, like I'm not going to start to draw people or draw monsters or, you know what I mean? Like, that's just not what I do. If it involves, you know, landscapes, buildings, you know, roads, train tracks, like, you know, simple thing, walls. I make the mundane look beautiful. Okay?
Simple, what's that?
Right.
Okay.
So if it fits that style, then I could do that. Mm-hmm. And it would make sense. But it's something that's not like, you know, like a portrait of a person. That's not what I do, really. So why would I do that? Yeah, we don't know. We've been discussing the new title. We have half our new album is already written. We're working very hard on getting the next album already together. And we're just deciding on titles.
Yeah, we're still
mulling
over titles.
We've got some good ideas.
There's no point.
Yeah, but we don't know what it is.
We got a lot of funny ones. You know, we always come up with some really hilarious shit.
Come on.
Oh, like really hilarious? Well, because we always use alliterations, we're just fucking, we just go off the handle with it. It's like, lose it. Okay, we're going to call it cheese and crackers.
Yeah,
right. And we're going to make a big hunk of cheese that looks like an anvil and surround it with crackers. I just don't think that's going to work.
Well, we have some very, very, actually very good ideas, but there's no point to reveal them here. But we can say that we have half the new album written. That's that we can say.
Okay. Meaning we do have a new tour already in 18 in Scandinavia.
17.
17.
17.
Come on.
Yeah, we're going to record.
You do like the Baron Hamburgers over here.
No, we're going to record a new record next year, as far as no question about it. And we plan to, in 2018, get back up to it.
I want to thank everyone who's come along with us on this tour, Rock and Bust. It's certainly been one big adventure with its highs and its lows. I want to thank everyone who's contributed to it and put in a lot of hard work and effort to make it happen. I also want to thank all the people who came out to see us and brought all that magic atmosphere.
I'm gonna look at it.
Da gjenstår det bare å si takk for denne gang. Skål. Og god jul.
Can the ghost